I've been using Enscape since version 1.9, almost about 7 years ago. And here are some videos and images I was making back then. Now, it might be hard to believe for the newer generations, but back then, this was really top-notch stuff. Well, at least for me. And since that release, I've used Enscape for many of my projects and significantly improved my rendering skills. Today, I want to share some tips and tricks that helped me elevate my renders from just okay to pretty awesome realistic renders. Now, I don't consider myself the best Enscape user out there at all. In fact, if you check out the Enscape forum, you'll be amazed and shocked by the high quality of work some users produce. From interior to exterior renders, the possibilities with Enscape are endless. But I like tracking my progress and I feel it could inspire you, showing you how you can present better your projects with Enscape. And today I'll break down how I created a series of images with Enscape, starting with a crucial but often overlooked step that applies not only to Enscape but to other softwares as well. Now, when creating an image, it's a common mistake to think everything needs to be built from scratch. New perspectives, magical lighting, figuring out colors, textures, etc., the works, but that's far from necessary. One key to success is starting with one or two reference images. These can set the direction for your render. In my case, I used an image from the Never Too Small book featuring the Warren, a compact apartment in Australia, with some really cool lighting, furniture, and overall composition that I loved. I began by quickly drafting the space up in SketchUp, modeling walls, floors, windows, etc. For my reference, I knew I wanted a portrait-oriented image of a living room with a yellow curtain in the foreground, vibrant large plants, a warm peach-toned sofa by a window that let in natural light, and a back wall with a wooden door, art frames, and other details, all over a tiled floor that caught soft shadows and a gold-covered closet to the right. Now, with this reference, I broke down my approach into four different parts. First, create a detailed base 3D model. Second, find quality 3D models similar to those in the reference images. Third, texture the scene to match the picture. Fourth, adjust the lighting and settings to mimic the original lighting setup. Now, thanks to my reference, I quickly identified the elements that I needed to start my image. And remember, don't limit your references to just architectural renderings. Maybe do exactly the opposite. Use photography, books, movies, and interior design websites are great for finding inspiration. Now let's move on to our second tip. Knowing our main composition, we need to optimize our 3D model accordingly. It's practical to avoid overmodeling and creating an excessively detailed model if we're not going to use all of it. This just wastes our resources and time. From the start, I save a scene with roughly the point of view I want in the composition so I can always refer back to it and track my progress. I also set this up in Enscape, exporting renders from each stage. I just open my Enscape window, go to the scene management, and adjust my scene, saving it also in my SketchUp scenes. Now, before I share this third tip, let's look at some old renders I did and where I went wrong by skipping a simple step. Now, if you zoom in on these images, you'll notice many corners and edges look unrealistically sharp. In reality, most materials and edges aren't that sharp. They all have a sort of bevel to them. And although Enscape doesn't currently offer a feature to round corners in the render engine, you can use plugins like Round Corner by Fredo to soften visible angles in your models. And it's very easy to use. Just select your angles, open the plugin, click on Round Corner, adjust the settings, and voila. My window transitions from looking like this to looking like this. Now, rounding the edges of this beam also enhances its appearance significantly. Now let's talk about sourcing your 3D models. Sure, Enscape offers a cool library of models and materials, actually a ton. Many of these you can tweak and personalize, but sometimes you might want more customization on your models or maybe on your materials. So I asked my Instagram community where to find free high quality models for SketchUp. And while I got many responses, I particularly like two sites. The first one is CG Tips, a classic, straightforward, and completely free site. You just pick your model and download it. The second is the Zeal Project, which works on a credit system, giving you a few free credits daily to download some high quality models. I also find that if you search well, you can discover great models in the SketchUp 3D warehouse, but you'll likely need to create the textures yourself. So some models I loved using include plans from the Zeal Project, sofas, a curtain from the 3D warehouse, and a chair and table from CG Tips. carpet came from the Enscape asset library, along with some tabletop items and background plants. These cool blinds were also from the 3D warehouse. For the door, I knew I needed a detailed model, not just a simple, plain one. So I looked up door hinges, a safety latch, a doorknob, and also the phone and light switch. I also shrunk the door slightly at the bottom and sides to make it look much more realistic. Now for our fifth tip, we need to focus on an element that adds realism and color to our image. Without this, our render would just look like a clay model, a clay render. And that of course is materials. For this image, several important materials were needed. First, the floor. I downloaded a floor texture from Quixel. This was free and very high quality. And to apply this material, I created a new material. Then I import the albedo map into the albedo texture, add a displacement texture, and then the roughness texture. Here, you don't want to overdo it, just enough to give the floor this specific texture. So these are the settings I used, and I really like the result. Next, we apply the wall material. Although we can't see much of the wall's texture in our reference photo due to the overexposure, I wanted there to be a grainy, rough texture on the walls in my close-up renders. So I also downloaded a wall material from Quixel and imported the normal and roughness maps. One thing that I forgot to mention is that in the roughness map, I imported previously on Photoshop and added an imperfection map just to see some scratches and dust, and then I exported it again as a JPEG. So here are the final settings I used, along with some renders showing a close-up of the walls. Here are some other wall material options directly from the Enscape material library, which, as you can see, work pretty well too. Then for the door texture, I'm going to apply a wooden texture also from Quixel. One thing I learned from the incredible videos at Modulus Render, which if you haven't checked out yet, I highly recommend you go and check out, is to add dust and scratches to your textures. You can head over to your roughness map, select a dust and scratches map from Quixel, that they're all free, and adjust the opacity. It's very simple. Now let's apply the leaf texture and adjust it in our image. We'll import our normal map, glossiness, roughness map, and finally the transparency map. These are the settings I used, and here's how the plant looks before, and here's how it looks after the adjustments. But what good is all of this if we don't know how to properly illuminate our space? Lighting is a crucial step we can't overlook. Now for this part, I also recommend watching some videos from Vlad in Modulus Render. He explains different methods for lighting your scene, and here, of course, I'm going to try a couple of them. So one of the coolest techniques is soft directional lighting, which you can see detailed in his videos. Essentially, although the natural sun in Enscape emits really hard shadows even at the lowest settings, one method to achieve softer lights is by using Enscape's artificial lights. In this case, I used sphere lights. So what I do is create a sort of tunnel that comes from the window, giving it some direction similar to the sun's. Then I place a sphere light next to each other and adjust their intensity. Here you can see the results with the directional lighting and how our shadows transition from this to looking like this. I also tried the cove lighting effect in this project. Essentially, we add white panels onto our model with some spotlights directed towards them. These lights help reflect some soft light onto our model, and we can also use a white dome HDRI to emit some non-bluish light onto our model. This is how the render looks without the lights, and this is how the render looks with the lights turned on. Another lighting scenario I tried was using tube lights outside the main window, then some rectangular lights outside the door, adjusting their direction and intensity. Finally, I added some spotlights onto the main plant to make it stand out much more and give it a nice shine. So here's the scene without them turned on, and here's with them turned on. So if I wanted to use my HDRIs as my lighting setup, I could do that as well. I would just go to the skybox option and import an HDRI I like. Finally, let's jump onto our image settings. Here, I usually leave the contrast at 50, turn on depth of field, adjust the field of view, then turn down the shadows and highlights, reduce shadow sharpness to 0 and sun brightness. And finally, just export this in high resolution. So these are some of the images I created using all of these tips, and overall I think these tips are useful if you're just starting out in Enscape and want to get a head start and improve your rendering skills. As always, I want to thank the team at Chaos for sponsoring this video and supporting this channel. Although they are sponsors of the video, They give me creative liberty to create my own type of content. Now, if you want to download Enscape and try this out for yourself, there will be a link in the description to download Enscape. Now, if you want to check out more Enscape tutorials, comment down below. I would love to make more videos like these. Meanwhile, you can check out this playlist right here that's all about rendering. Thank you all for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.